Changes have been announced in the War Cabinet, which has been increased from 6 to 8 members. New members are the trade unionist, Mr. Ernest Bevin, and the former Air Minister, Mr. Kingsley Wood. Neville Chamberlain, who was replaced as Prime Minister by Mr. Winston Churchill in May, has resigned as Lord President of the Council. He's suffering from terminal cancer. He's replaced by Sir John Anderson. There have been heavy air attacks on London and Merseyside. RAF bombers have attacked Berlin and Cologne, the oil refinery and storage depot at Magdeburg, and the Bosch factory at Stuttgart, which makes magnetos and sparking plugs. The British have been shelling Calais, and the Germans have shelled Dover, where has been some damage to property and one man was killed. The Navy has warned of the threat of invasion because of the good weather. This has been Coventry War Week, and well over £500,000 has been contributed in savings. So many £5 notes are circulating in the city that shopkeepers are finding it difficult to provide change. The reason is believed to be the high wages for Coventry munition workers and those employed in the aircraft industry. The new Citizens Advice Bureau in Earl Street is receiving 30 inquiries a day. Many concern domestic and matrimonial issues. Sport and Coventry have defeated Notts County 3-1 in an away game. Two players were sent off. Entertainment and the film Gone with the Wind is proving very popular at the Savoy Cinema. You are reminded that blackout time is from 7:15 p.m. to 6:40 a.m. Finally, a Mr. Wenham of St. Patrick's Road, a former merchant seaman, injured in a road accident, said, "Fancy surviving a submarine attack only to be knocked off my cycle on my own doorstep." He's confined to bed with sore ribs.
In 1940, Coventry, with its historic medieval centre, was a compact city that was benefiting from the increased prosperity that rearmament and war production had brought. The so-called shadow factories belonged to the established firms who had become engaged in secretly producing components for the war effort and had brought workers and money to the city. During the war, Coventry, together with Birmingham, was the hub of Britain's efforts to stop the German military machine. By November 1940, the London Blitz was at its height. But a few of the other cities had experienced the full horror of aerial bombing. Most, like Coventry, had undergone a few sporadic raids of little consequence. On the night of November the 14th, 1940, Coventry's phony war was over, when the largest single raid ever directed at an English provincial city took place. By 7:10 p.m, as Captain Winterbotham, head of the RAF section at SIS HQ, dryly observed, the bombs were coming down in a big way. This was the beginning of what the Germans had called Operation Moonlight Sonata.
I looked out the window about 8 o'clock, and I could see that it was no ordinary raid. So we had our meal, and then I re-uniformed up, and I had to walk over a field. I lived right out at Wyking, and I had to walk over a field. As I was walking on, I got a tin hat and a gas mask, and I felt quite safe with that and a uniform. And as I got to the junction of Hitswell Highway and Macaulay Road, there was a canister of incendiary bombs came down, and they lit up the whole field. And there was a warden guarding a builder's yard, Gale's Builder's Yard, on the corner of Hipswell Highway. And he called me over and asked me if I would mind staying with him, because his other wardens were putting the incendiaries out, you see. So this I did, but fortunately the wood yard didn't go up. It was very fortunate, that was, because it would have been, you know, quite a fire. Anyway, when it was sort of quieting down again and they were sort of bombing the other side of the city, I popped back home then, on my way back home, and we'd had an incendiary through the roof. And my brand new husband, who I'd left looking after the dog, had put it out. So I cleared up some of the mess and had a quick cup of tea and then set off again for the post, dodging the bombs. And I wouldn't let my husband come with me. I said, no, you look after the house, because, you know, you had an awful job to get things in those days for the house, you know, furnishings and things like that. And
Coventry city centre had largely been devastated. Whole areas obliterated in a raid lasting throughout the night. 500 or more planes dropped over 500,000 kilograms of incendiary bombs. It was the last of these that had destroyed the cathedral, which remains the most poignant reminder of Coventry's suffering. Other raids on Coventry, notably the following April the 8th, were to be more concentrated. None had the physical or emotional impact of the November raid.
I'd driven an ambulance down between a high wall on one side and one of the... it was actually a mill on the other side, down in Cox Street, where they made ribbon. And the whole building was aflame. And there was somebody injured down in a shelter at the very far end. It was wide enough to drive the vehicle down, and I could turn it round at the bottom, which I did do. We got the patient on board, and then I just seemed to lose my nerve to drive out again. And the person I'd got with me, he was only a small person, and I could have flattened him any time, but he threatened to give me a good hiding unless I drove out, realising, of course, if I didn't drive out, my nerve would have gone. And, of course, after that, I did drive out, and everything was all right. But the people of Coventry just... I wouldn't say there was panic at all. A case that we went to where houses were bombed on the Fosel Road. We went sorting out and we asked the people there whether all the houses were clear. And they said, oh, there was an old lady in number 5. I said, which one is that? Because the walls at the back of the houses were all down. And they pointed the house and they said, she'd be under the stairs. So we moved all the rubble from by this stair doorway that was under the stairs and called to her, you know, to come out. And all she said was, what are you doing in my house? And you shouldn't be in here. How did you get in? And it was only then that we was able to take her, get her out of the house and to a reception area where she was safe.
The destruction of Coventry had undoubtedly the profoundest of effects. Coventry had been a target because of its importance to the war effort. A new word came into being, Coventrate, which means to destroy utterly. But how true is this picture of a city damaged almost beyond repair?
The devastation was pretty severe, particularly in the city centre. And one of the reasons for that was that the Germans were intending to undermine civilian morale in Coventry by destroying people's homes. And also, of course, they used, as well as high-explosive bombs, they used incendiary bombs, which set light to a lot of the city, including, of course, the cathedral. Outside of the central areas, the devastation wasn't anywhere near so great. And so the shadow factories, for example, were largely untouched.
The immediate cost to Coventry, one it has still not come to terms with, was the loss of 550 of its citizens, men, women, children. 550 identified casualties. Although over 1,000 were feared perished, the authorities took the unprecedented step of organising something not seen in England since the Middle Ages, a mass burial. This elegant and moving memorial, where so many Coventry citizens lie buried, will be the scene on the 14th of November 1990 of the service to commemorate the passing of 50 years since that most significant night, lest we forget. Whatever the long-term costs of the raid, the immediate tasks facing the services and people of Coventry were survival, rescue, and reconstruction. George Sanders was a fireman on duty that fateful night.
We got sent down to Eagle Street, and Eagle Street was in the thick of it, as you possibly know. We got down Eagle Street, and what would be fine, the houses on fire, especially the roofs, and the old people were being helped out, and they stood there petrified. They couldn't move, looking at the fire. Anyway, a crew took them away. Some went up into the factory at the top, O'Brien's factory at the top of the Eagle Street. There used to be a brook running under the road. It's all closed up now. We got down there and we got the appliance, pumping water, alpha leather, and all of a sudden somebody said, "Hey, they're over the top of us." And they were, God blimey. The bombers were over, it seemed to be over the top of us. All of a sudden they got that damn close and I moved away. Moved just away a little bit. And he dropped a bomb straight on the top of the appliance. Smashed it. I put that out of order. Now what we done? Well, we didn't know what to do. So there was no water, no nothing. I went up the road to find the others. I didn't know where to look. So I went round some of the streets, getting the people out, but taking them home or doing something for them. And that's the history of the Blitz as far as we were concerned. But it's not like that at all. It's bloody murder. Believe you me, it is. To know very well you're going to get it down the neck in the next breath. But anyway, luckily we escaped. And here we are today.
Coventry's response to its trial of fire has been distinctive. The Cross of Nails ministry of the new Coventry Cathedral, the phoenix from the ashes, is a worldwide symbol of Coventry's determination that the suffering of those who lie in the London Road Cemetery shall never happen again. This simple altar with its stark cross was erected in the still smoking ruins of the old cathedral, a scene which so affected the late King George VI. The inscription reads, "Father, forgive."
Hitler has sent his troops into Romania. His advisors have entered Bucharest. Hundreds of Britons working in Romania's oil industry are reported to be fleeing the country. Following the worsening of relations with Japan, the Foreign Office is considering advising British subjects in the Far East to return home. St. Paul's Cathedral has been damaged in an air raid. A bomb exploded on the roof not far from the Great Dome. No one was injured, but great blocks of masonry fell onto the high altar. The air battle has continued in southern England. The Germans have threatened that London will be annihilated. The Archbishop of Canterbury has counselled against reprisal raids on German civilians. This would mean sinking to the enemy's level. The 150 women conductors on Coventry buses are proving courteous and efficient. The relatively high starting wage of £3, 1 shilling and sixpence for a 48-hour week is proving attractive to women. Coventry's National Emergency Committee has approved two schemes for deep shelters. They will each accommodate 12,000 people. They will be sited under central parks.
A community at war. The full force of this phrase was brought to Coventrians on a fateful morning in November 1940. The bombing of the city during the German raid Moonlight Sonata had finished its hideous nighttime music of screeching shell and explosion. Yet as the citizens, shocked beyond words, emerged the next day, they saw the nightmare continued in a grotesque landscape of smouldering rubble and twisted metal. The smell of death and destruction hung over the entire city. In a few short hours of night, lives, buildings, hearts and hopes had been shattered, and the very essence of normal daily reality utterly wiped out. Yet what exactly was the daily reality of those dark and sombre days?
I think my first memory is incendiary bombs. They fell at the bottom of Watery Lane in the field. They were aiming for the Dunlop and sort of missed with most of them. Just a few hit the factory itself.
Apart from the shelters, there were changes too for other essential elements of survival, most obviously in the rationing of food. Ration books and coupons were issued, and the entire available food supply was strictly controlled. So how did this work, and how did people manage in reality?
Well, it was just the basic things, you see. You couldn't say you had luxuries. There was no luxuries to be had, because you only had 10 pence worth of meat and a quarter of a pint of corned beef.
Luckily, it was rationed, and you got what you were entitled to. You managed. Of course, you could only have your ration, but it done. You managed it. We used to get a few odd things. I mustn't say too much. We used to find a place that had been blitzed and help ourselves to a tin of this or a can of this or something, but I don't think the people would have minded it. I got one instance where there was chap come to me one day, being a leading farmer, was in charge of a crew, and he come and he said, "I got it come from Kay's. Used to be Kay's Ways Pays, a little firm that used to sell things cheap. You could get cheap cigarettes before the war, of course, and cheap tins of fruit and all like that." And he said, in a shop in Fleet Street, was it? Little Park Street, bottom of Little Park Street. If you can get some tins out, they were in the cellar and the building was condemned because it was dangerous. He said, if you can get some out, he said, you can have every case you get out, if you get four cases out, you can have one. We'll have three and you can have one. So we took some blokes down and got these out, so we had a few cases of things, but of course they'd all got labels on. And them being wet in the cellar, the labels had come off. So when you opened your tin, you never knew what you was going to get. So we was feeding ourselves in Wheatley Street School. Used to say to one of the chaps was a cook, "What we're having today, we'll have some pilchards today." When he opened it was red plums or pineapples or something. So we had to have that for dinner because you hadn't got anything else. But it was rather comical, that was.
Well, the rationing was very difficult altogether, but my husband was a diabetic and he had extra rations, you see. He needed it for his diet. But the one thing we always had, we were quite elite, was sugar. I never took sugar and neither did he. So we always had a very good swap. And I've swapped sugar for almost everything. A couple of eggs, cigarettes, butter... You can think of, most people wanted sugar, and I got the wonderful swap. I was lucky.
A student nurse of the time recalls,
"We couldn't buy very much because the clothing coupons, and of course our salaries were so small, we didn't have very much money. But I do remember that we were able to go to Owen Owens and get a pair of black stockings for ninepence in old money. We could go to Lyons Cafe and have a chocolate biscuit and a coffee for about fourpence. On payday, everyone made a beeline for Fishy Moore's, where we could get a full meal for a shilling, but 28 shillings a month didn't go very far, and many letters of mine have been sent home without a stamp, because I didn't have the money for a stamp.
One simple practical philosophy dominated all aspects of daily life in Coventry at this time: make do and mend. The Women's Voluntary Service actually held classes and produced magazines packed with articles on how to make the most of the little there was available, as all commodities ran short. How to make do and mend. And this phrase is also used as the title of a book on those times by Margaret Woods, and the exhibition here at St John's House, Warwick. We asked her how the women in particular had managed at that time.
Women were, looking back, very philosophical. I mean, I imagine that perhaps they'd felt resentment or even bitterness during the war, that they'd had their ability to buy clothes and choose clothes very much curtailed. But looking back, they will say things like, well, there were more important things to worry about. You know, you didn't have time to worry about what you were going to put on in the morning. So they were very tolerant of what happened, I think. So that was interesting. The other thing that was interesting was, I think, the make, do, and mend aspect. The many different ways they employed of getting round shortages and restrictions. The fabrics they used, whether it's a bit of parachute or an old blanket, you know, with ingenuity and imagination and patience, they transform these unlikely materials into garments which, although they're not high fashion, are extremely interesting and serviceable. So that impressed me very much.
Shortages led to ingenuity. A chronic shortage of stockings was overcome by mixing sand and water, painting this on the legs and then brushing the sand off when dry. A line drawn on the back of the leg provided the master touch for the fashionable seam. It was indeed the women who played the crucial role in maintaining some sort of normality, both as individuals and as members of organisations such as the WVS and the Land Army. Women also kept the factories going, helped maintain essential services such as public transport, and did crucial work on the land. During the war, Alice Flavel was in charge of the 16-acre smallholding on the Stoneleigh Road at Baggington.
During the war, we were graded. The Ministry of Agriculture come round and they graded each smallholding. Well, I was lucky to be graded A. But the ones that went down to E, they were evicted. And then the acreage was let to someone else to cultivate the land. During the war, of course, you couldn't get the local labour. A lot of the men went to the war, of course, and the boys were in the factory. They had to do all sorts of things. So I had two Italian prisoners of war. And they used to come from Warwick on a mini coach, and every morning, and collected at night.
The Women's Land Army in Britain as a whole eventually became 80,000 strong as women heeded the requests to lend a hand on the land and dig for victory. The now famous courage, determination and humour of the men while away in the struggle for victory was matched in every part by the women at home and their struggle for survival. Charlie Sheffield pays this tribute to the women of Coventry.
It built a great comradeship amongst the people. Especially the women, they were marvellous. I mean, a woman you'd think would be terrified of her life. She'd see you standing there all getting hose up, wringing wet, and you could see, obviously see you were bleary-eyed, had no sleep. And they'd come walk, they'd walk a couple of hundred yards to go and fetch you a cup of tea. We even had some publicans bring a bucket full of beer out.
during the night. Here, get a drink, my lads, you're doing a good job, sort of stuff. And, you used to know the publicans, because if you used a pub, you knew who they were, but they'd come out the cellars with a bucket full of beer, bring a glass with them, a couple of glasses, and you dipped your glass in and had a drink and thanked them very much and went carried on with the job again. It was a big help. It made a marvellous spirit amongst the people, no doubt about that.
Soviet troops are reported to be entering Romania from the south. 20 Soviet divisions have been massing near the border. The activity is thought to be in preparation for an attempt to gain control of the Danube Delta. The Admiralty has announced that the cruiser HMS Ajax, which with the Exeter and Achilles won the Battle of the River Plate, has sunk two Italian destroyers and crippled a third during a battle in the Mediterranean. The destroyers were holding the sides and funnels. Their magazines exploded as they sank. RAF raids on Germany are reported from neutral sources as proving highly effective. Berlin has suffered extensive damage. A number of key factories have been partially wrecked. The main post office has been gutted. The main gasworks is badly damaged. At home now, and in London, a German bomb narrowly missed number 10. The treasury next door was severely damaged. The German bombers appear to be turning their attention to the Midlands. Coventry has experienced its biggest air raid to date. 140 bombs were dropped on Monday night. Since August the 17th, the city has been attacked on 17 occasions. The Director of Education in Coventry, Mr. F.H. Harrod, has been expressing concern about the state of school shelters. Mr. Harrod says that the shelters have been so misused by the public at night that they aren't fit for the children the next day. Two large shelters had been filled with people the previous night. Most of the time they were singing and making hideous noises. They left behind them so much litter, including beer bottles, that in one shelter, five bucketfuls had to be removed. A Coventry soldier has written home from Iceland. Gunner Leonard Jelly of the Royal Artillery says the Icelanders are shy but friendly. They are clean and sturdy looking, with healthy complexions and blonde hair. He says the women in particular possess a very well-developed sense of dress and harmony in colours.
The show must go on. The old show business motto was given a new significance in Coventry during 1940. As people struggled to maintain some sort of daily normality in their lives in the face of bombing raids, rationing, and constant shortages, any form of entertainment was a blessed relief. The cinema, radio, music and variety shows, and local dances all played a crucial part in improving morale. They help people to forget the daily tragedies, disasters and discomfort, and to remember the good old days before the war. In itself, an important reminder of what the sacrifice and the struggle was all about. The cinema, for instance, was still a temporary haven of delightful escape. Films such as Gone with the Wind and Dr. Cyclops played to packed houses in Coventry in 1940. The audience would often sit through the most intense bombing raids. A slide would appear on the screen advising people to leave, but many stayed for the end of the last reel.
You had a boyfriend, you were all right. You got an evening in the cinema, possibly. But there was always complimentary tickets available on Monday nights for the Opera House, which was the Repertory Theatre, and the Hippodrome. And a few of these complimentary tickets would be available to anyone that was off duty that evening. So it was almost a fight to get a ticket if you were finishing at 6 o'clock that night.
My name is Bill Edkins. I used to be the chief operator of the Astoria, and this particular photograph was taken in 1940 when we were showing Hell's Kitchen. Strange it may believe, apart from the Dead End Kids, Ronald Reagan was also the star. This particular film had an H certificate that meant no one under 16 could attend the viewing. We're now in the projection room looking at a pair of simplex projectors with Western Electric sound. From this room came your entertainment for many years under my control. A test of memory. Maybe you saw one or two of these programmes that we showed between March and June of 1940.
Coventry Theatre, or Hippodrome as it was then, was a focal point of Coventry's wartime entertainment. Len Pepper, a trumpeter with the Hippodrome's orchestra, recalls those days.
Well, my first recollection of a bomb, or being close to a bomb, was one Sunday evening when we'd been giving a concert at Hinckley, and that was the Coventry Theatre Orchestra, and I came back with Mr. Pethers in the car, and he said, "Would you like stop for a drink at the Mount Pleasant pub at Walsgrave?" So we stopped there, and then we came through the town and was just past the Rex Cinema when a bomb dropped on the Rex Cinema, hitting the organ at the back. Lifted a car up in the air, it felt about a foot, but I suppose it would only be an inch or two. And the week before the Blitz, we'd been giving a concert at the Colston Hall at Bristol. We came back, we went down by coach and came back, and there were a raid on when we got near Coventry. We could see it when we got on Gibbet Hill. So the coach stopped there for a while, because they said, "No use going into Coventry while the bomb's dropping, but it seems they're going to drop all night." So the coach driver said, "Well, I'm going to take the coach home," because he said, "I've got children there." I said, "So have I." So I said, "Let's go." So anyway, we decided to come, and he asked me if he could drop me at the Cedars pub instead of coming up Kingsbury Road, because I lived in Kingsbury Road at that time. And just I got off the bus, a bomb was whistling down, you know, like that sort of thing, you know. I think my feet touched the ground about three times between the pub and our house. And Then, of course, it was the Blitz the week after, and we was at the theatre then, playing from 2 till 3 till 7 because of the bombing. We'd cut out the late shows. And I think Macari and his Dutch band, was it Dutch accordion band? That was right, Macari and his Dutch accordionist. They was there, and at 7 o'clock, just as the show finished, a little while after, 10 minutes past 7, I think it was, and the sirens all went, and so, of course, we stayed at the theatre and got under the stone stairs that take you up to the artist bar and dressing rooms for about an hour. Then I decided I was going to go home, but Mr. Pethers said he wasn't going, we'd get killed. He says, you'll get killed, because I was going home on my bicycle. I said, well, I might as well get killed going home on my bike as get killed staying in the theatre. So off I went, and when I got against the Elvis had a factory on the town side of the railway on Holyhead Road at that time, and that was all on fire. And there was a steam engine, goods train on the railway, and that had been, the blast had blown that off the track and down the bank, and that was all steaming away. I'll be pleased when I get past this on my bike. I landed home anyway, eventually. And next morning I went down about 6 o'clock to see if the theatre was still standing. I saw scenes there which I'd only seen on films of the 1914-18 war. The tram cars lying on the side in front of the theatre. And a bomb through the foyer, as a matter of fact. It was a time bomb though, so it didn't do much damage to the theatre, but we had quite a lot of incendiary bombs on the top of the theatre, but they was thrown off by fire watchers, so the theatre got saved. We had the dancing troupe, which was there at the time of the Blitz, and most of them lived down Barris Lane, lodged down there, and of course after the Blitz they was bombed out, so Mr. Newsom let them have the large dressing room. He rigged it out with beds and blankets and everything, and stoves for cooking and lighting, and they stayed at the theatre for quite a time until things got normal again. But before that, before the Blitz, Mr. Pethers had put a fire watching list up. It was all voluntary fire watching. He wanted your names on to do it, and nobody put the names on. But after the Blitz, when the Adorables was there staying there, he had a job to find a space to get your name on. So of course we, although they were the Adorables they were called, but we used to call them the Deplorables. Didn't really, because they were nice girls really, like the orchestra, only we want girls.
Entertainment also reached into the home. Apart from relaying vital news and information, the radio, or wireless, was another godsend of relief.
Well, the orchestra used to do regular broadcasts before the war, so much so that, in fact, Charlie Shadwell was the first one to have the orchestra on the air, and that was really done through Jack Wilson, who was the pianist at the time, and he used to have his Versatile 5 as well. And Jack, I believe, now lives in Worthing, a very fine pianist. And when they had the new theatre built, through broadcasting regularly, they had a studio built at the theatre, which is now the restaurant. But it was all built to BBC designs and specifications. And, of course, that went on landline then to the BBC, to Birmingham, then I think to Droitwich from there. But later on, of course, we went, when bombing and everything started and landlines were possibly getting bombed, we used to go to Birmingham. We went one night to do one for the forces. We did 8 from 10:30 till 11 o'clock at night. That was for the forces. That was after the Blitz. We did 4 in December 1940 and 4 in January 1941. Late at night, but we had one there, and we went down into the shelter. As soon as we got there, there was a raid on. But anyway, Mr. Bethers said, I think we ought to do our bit. The soldiers are doing there. Are we going to broadcast? So we said we would. Never mind the bombing. But it was rather peculiar to see the announcer sitting there with a tin hat on and a gas mask at the alert, making the announcements. And then while we was playing, there was a bomb dropped across the road and a piece of plaster about a yard square fell down off the ceiling while we were playing. And, of course, everything was live in those days. There was no recordings, not then. Well, this tune, Music While You Work, which they use, was written by Eric Coates. And, of course, it was used daily for quite a few years. But if you'd like to hear the Coventry Theatre Orchestra playing Music While You Work, then we can listen to it, because I believe they're on the air now. I'll switch on and see.
Music While You Work is played this afternoon in Birmingham by the Coventry Theatre Orchestra, conductor William Pepper.
Shifts were quite long, at least 8-hour shifts, and if there was a warning, then you were expected to stay over. So we didn't have much time for entertainment, but we found the radio a great comfort. Of course, they were very limited telling us what had gone on war-wise. They were very careful what they said, but the main entertainment that we liked was Tommy Hanley, and I can't think of the other programmes, but that was our main entertainment. And
dances and balls were as popular as ever when people had the time.
Well, we did a little, because we always had we had to have our nights off. And, of course, the hospitals, the nurses had their dances, which we were very pleased to join in with, particularly at Gulson Road, because they had some very good dances there, the Gulson Road Hospital. But we'd go to the cinema at times. I remember going to the Alexandra Theatre myself on one or two occasions. And on going to the theatre, as soon as the manager saw the uniform, we'd be shown to seats on the balcony upstairs in a position where he knew we were, so that if anything happened, we'd be there to help him and his customers as well. So it worked both ways.
John Spencer is the organiser of Coventry's modern-day commemorative Blitz Balls. We asked him how long he had been organising these events.
Well, I started the first Blitz Ball about 6 months before the 40th anniversary, which was November 1980.
And how many have you organised?
Well, this is the 25th.
And what goes on at the balls?
Well, really everything, from about 6:30 till 12:30. We have the nostalgics that play all the old-time sing-along songs. They do sequence and ballroom. Then later on, the big band comes on that really takes us to town all night with the Glenn Miller stuff. Now, during the night, it's like a big cabaret. We have the melody makers come on, all dressed up in the uniforms of the 40s, and they sing all the wartime songs of the 40s. It's absolutely a knockout. People stand on the chairs, waving the flags, and you can see chaps of 70 with tears streaming down the face.
So nostalgia returns?
Nostalgia returns in a very big way.
The Blitz Balls provide a special link between then and now. They remind people of the camaraderie and spirit that lightened those dark times. As they say, there's no business like show business. And in 1940, it played its unique role in the war effort. In its own
there has been a meeting between Hitler and General Franco. The British government suspects that Hitler is trying to bully the Spanish leader into allowing German troops to attack Gibraltar through Spain. Hitler has also had a meeting with Monsieur Laval. The Vichy government has announced that France will not fight Britain. The French ambassador in Spain has now told British representatives that Vichy is on the point of deciding whether to hand over Toulon and the French fleet to Germany. In America, President Roosevelt, opening his election campaign, has reaffirmed his determination to keep the United States at peace unless he is attacked. In his review of the Battle of Britain, Captain Harold Balfour, the Under Secretary of State for Air, has announced the formation of the RAF Eagle Squadron, which consists entirely of volunteers from the United States. In the Commons, the Agriculture Minister, Mr. R.S. Hudson, has told MPs that our food situation has materially improved. Stocks of meat on the hoof have improved, and we have a well-balanced agriculture to enter the second winter of the war. The Food Minister, Lord Woolton, has announced a plan to help fish and chip fryers by providing a subsidy on the cost of their potatoes. This is in recognition of the importance of fish and chips to working-class households. German bombers continue to attack industrial targets in the West Midlands. The most recent raid was more widespread, with incidents in several scattered areas. A number of commercial premises were set on fire. A 24-year-old Coventry man has been brought before Kenilworth Petty Sessions for unlawful wounding by battering his wife with an iron bar. The incident happened in a field at Kenilworth when the couple were having a Sunday afternoon walk. The man is a graduate from Birmingham University, and he was said to have been infuriated by what he felt was his wife's shallow behaviour. They had been forced into marriage by her pregnancy. The woman was detained in Warnford Hospital at Leamington for a day.
The 15th of November, 1940. The citizens of Coventry, numb with shock, emerged from their nighttime shelters after the heaviest bombing raid ever concentrated on a British city. The scene of utter destruction that greeted them defied belief. One question was on every mind: why us? In the organized horrors of war, little happens by accident or out of sheer malice. There were indeed answers to the question, why? And clear reasons why the dot on the map that was Coventry had just received such special treatment. How aware were German intelligence of shadow factory activity in Coventry?
I don't think the Germans were very well aware of what was going on in Coventry, and one clear indication of that is that when they came to bomb the city on the 14th of November, most of the effort was directed at the city centre. In fact, something like two-thirds of the old medieval centre of Coventry was either destroyed or very badly damaged. And the shadow factories around the outskirts of the city were largely untouched. It was places in the centre, towards the centre, like Daimler's at Radford, that were worst hit.
If the Germans had not been so aware of the shadow factory activity, what then could have been a possible reason for such a concentrated raid as hit Coventry on the 14th of November?
Well, there are many explanations that have been put forward. One is that it was in retaliation for an RAF raid on Munich, when Hitler was giving a speech rallying the faithful. Another explanation is that it was simply an act of terror designed to strike fear into the British public. And actually, Coventry was unusual in that it was advertised as having been badly hit by a raid quite soon after the 14th. And the impact of this was actually to raise morale, so in a way the thing bounced back on the Germans. But undoubtedly too, they were after Coventry as a centre of industrial production, and of course it was a major centre of production for the aircraft industry, but also for other armaments too.
The city was the centre of the British car manufacturing industry. Factories such as those owned by Daimler, Rover, Standard and Roots already had the necessary equipment for the production of armaments and aircraft. As early as 1936, the armed service chiefs and a group of Midland car manufacturers devised the first scheme for secretly rearming the nation for possible war using the cover of car manufacturing. Because of the secrecy involved, the factories were known as shadow factories. To the world outside, especially Germany, factories such as the Standard No. 1 on Fletchhamstead Highway, Daimler No. 1 at Cap Martin Road, and the Roots Group No. 1 at Aldermore Lane were still involved in car production. However, behind the facade, they produced the Mercury and Pegasus engines and the lightweight Blenheim bombers for the RAF. To increase production, a second shadow factory scheme was deployed. This involved Rover No. 2, Daimler No. 2 at Brown Lane, and Roots No. 2 at Ryton-on-Dunsmore. Also involved was the Standard No. 2 at Banner Lane, which, completed just after the outbreak of the war, was the largest shadow factory in the city. Factory workers of the time recall what conditions were like in the factories.
Ralph Herbert at that time was one of the biggest manufacturers of machine tools virtually in the world. We were making machine tools, lathes and drilling machines and capstans for factories all over Europe and the world as well.
Well, the umber car production was rapidly switched over to wartime car production, as instance Montgomery's snipe that is very famous here in Coventry here at the moment. There was a lot of that switched over to that production, but of course having regards to the fact that I left Humber in 1939, so what was happening in that time as far as war effort was concerned was only in its very, very early infancy. But they did build special versions of snipes, and also the Minx Magnificent that was known in those pre-war days was rapidly turned over for army use as well, both army, RAF, navy. There was a hell of a lot of Minx used in the services. As we've seen in the early days after the war, some was painted Air Force blue, others was Navy blue, and others was khaki, a hell of a lot of them.
And Coventry, at that time, we were building Lancasters. Oh, well, in the Blitz it would be Whitleys. They were building Oxfords. They were building aero engines. They were building armoured cars at the Alvis. They were building machine tools. They were building armoured cars and tanks at the Daimler. Several small places were building, making machine guns. So Coventry was a very, very high production area. Before the invasion, of course, from Horsley up to Baggington on what was then the Coventry bypass was chock-a-block with Whippet cars. Well, these are a six-man troop carrier, tracked, like a small tank, open-top small tank, if you like. And they were, so the whole length, which must have been 4 or 5 miles, around the outskirts of Coventry. And they also, to protect these, they had smoke pots. So all the way down, say, Wobbly Avenue and Fletchamstead Highway, whenever there's any sign of a raid, they would light these smoke pots, and they burnt crude oil, and black belching crude oil smoke would drift up and put a blanket of smoke over the city so that the reconnaissance pictures couldn't be taken of what we'd got and the fact that we were getting ready for the invasion.
Those of us was on production, the accent it was to avoid scrap. And we was in right trouble if it could be proved that we'd deliberately done anything wrong. But scrap was almost non-existent. And I don't recall any particular effort as far as within the confines of Armstrong Sedley as far as scrap is concerned, except for the normal procedures, which of course would be increased as volume increased, volume of production increased. But regarding the scrap, well do I remember when park railings and any railings of all sorts which had got molten, got cast iron in it or got
some sort of form of metal in it. They was all confiscated, sort of disappeared overnight, so to speak. And of course, they was telling us that they was going to be made into bombs, so we didn't mind that. If it, the bigger, the better.
A lot of the factories had machine guns on the roof, Lewis guns for defence. And these were manned by the Home Guard. And I know there's one instance where the Home Guard had the standard put a few bullet holes through a Whitley, again low flying, low cloud, and flying near the factory. And in the enthusiasm, they fired before they'd identified it, and they put some holes through the tail of the Whitley. But other than that, that's all the defence that there was for these factories.
And of camouflage was used terrifically. Oh, and Brighton, that was all totally camouflaged. And the big test house that is right almost as you're coming into Brighton village, which is the nearest point, the very, very large concrete block, that was aero engine test sheds, that was. And that was camouflaged tremendously, that was.
They were camouflage, paint of course, brown and green paint to camouflage them. But we always thought it was a waste of time, really, camouflaging, say, the roof of a place like the Standard, when you had the Standard Cinema, which was a new cinema built in 1938, which was white concrete. And you must have been able to see the Standard Cinema, I would think, from 50 miles away. And if you were coming in from the east and aiming for the Standard Cinema, you came straight over the Standard factory, which was must have been a wonderful aiming point for any bomber coming into the Standard.
Was the whole concept of shadow factories kept a secret from the citizens of Coventry?
No, far too many of the citizens of Coventry were working in the shadow factories. There's quite an interesting story of a shadow factory at Birmingham associated with the Austin Motor Company, because when that was built towards the end of the 30s, on one famous occasion, some gentlemen were found perambulating the field where the factory was going up, taking photographs of it. And of course they could easily have been German spies, and they weren't accosted for some time. Eventually it turned out that they were local people interested in what was going up in the area.
In addition to the shadow factories, Coventry was also home to various Hawker Siddeley operations, one of Britain's largest official aircraft manufacturers. The Germans explained that they had chosen Coventry partly in retaliation for the raid on Munich, but largely because it was the centre of the British aircraft industry. To many, this seemed an astonishing statement. Yet there were people on both sides who knew this was not too far from the truth. And in that raid, at least 15 major plants contributing to aircraft and armaments manufacture were destroyed.
Basically, I understand that there had been a raid where a historic place in Germany had been bombed. And as Coventry had a historic value, but also, I mean, Coventry has always been the centre of production, particularly for car industry. And I have a map of a reconnaissance flight that was taken August before the war started. And I think that picture was taken by an airship on a goodwill mission, and they were photographing places like Coventry for bombing. And on that photograph, all the Coventry factories have all been listed. So before the war started, Germany knew where our production was and where the factories were, so that all these reconnaissance photographs would be issued, and that's how they bombed this reconnaissance they'd done before the war.
There is one more element to the question, why Coventry? An element more complex and disturbing than the destruction of the heart of an armaments and aircraft industry. This relates to the widely held belief that the British government knew of the Coventry raid in sufficient advance to have effectively evacuated the city. However, to have done so would have informed the Germans that the famous Enigma code had been broken. Certainly the information gained by cracking this code and intercepting crucial messages from German high command was vital to the overall war effort. But was the city of Coventry sacrificed to preserve Enigma?
That is simply not known for sure. The evidence now seems to point to the fact that the government knew maybe 5 or 6 hours in advance of the raid. And they did their best to intercept the German radio beams which guided the aircraft to Coventry, but the jamming mechanism failed to work effectively. They also attempted to destroy German aircraft from their bases on the continent, to some effect, but obviously not very successful in total. No, I don't think Coventry was sacrificed. It would have been an impossible task to get people out of the town so quickly. Undoubtedly, however, there could have been some mobilisation of the civilian population. The problem is whether there would have been panic and people would have died in the rush, as it were.
We began this programme asking the question, why Coventry? How much of a surprise to the Coventrians was that raid in November 1940?
Well, Coventry had been attacked on something like 18 occasions between mid-August and the 12th of November. So it wasn't a surprise that there was a raid. It's the scale of the raid. It was a very dramatic raid indeed compared with what had gone on anywhere else in the country before. So I think it was a tremendous surprise. And that surprise is reflected in the fact that the story of Coventry on that fateful night has lived on, and I don't think that's just because of the destruction to the cathedral, but it was simply the scale of the raid and the fact that it was such a tremendous shock to not just the local people but the nation as a whole, I think.
We began with the question, why Coventry? Yet, in the frighteningly cool logic that sometimes prevails in war, it becomes only too clear that the ominous train of events, from car manufacturing to shadow factories, made it inevitable that Coventry was the all-too-obvious candidate for the first major raid of a civilian target that had basically military objectives.
Italy has invaded Greece following the rejection of an Italian government ultimatum demanding the right to occupy certain strategic points of Greek territory. On hearing the news that Athens had been bombed, Mr. Churchill declared, "Then we must bomb Rome." Fighting between Greek and Italian forces has continued in Albania. For Britain, the main issue is the strategic importance of Greek territorial waters and bases such as Crete. The Minister of Health, Mr. Malcolm MacDonald, has asked local authorities to keep a watch on rents. People whose homes have been bomb damaged or destroyed are having difficulty with rents which are being demanded. There have been further air raids in the Midlands. German pilots appear to have jettisoned their bombs in scattered rural areas. In Coventry, it is reported that motorists are misusing their headlights during the blackout. There is also a problem with cycle lights. The Chief Constable, Captain Hector, is looking into the matter. a number of Kenilworth residents have been fined for contravening the blackout regulations. One woman who lives at Castle Green in Kenilworth has been fined £1 for permitting a bonfire in her garden. A police officer put the fire out with two buckets of water. As a precaution against an outbreak of typhoid, which might arise if drainage or water mains were damaged in an air raid, immunisation clinics are to be opened. The Chief Medical Officer, Dr. Massey, says the courses will consist of three injections at weekly intervals. A scheme is to be introduced in Coventry to scrap railings. They will be surrendered for the scrap metal campaign. Sport. Hunter's Moon the Fourth, ridden by Gordon Richards, won the Cesarewitch Stakes at Newmarket. Playing before the smallest gate of the season, only 500, Coventry lost 2-1 at home to Northampton. Entertainment, and Coventry cinemas will now open from 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. on Sundays.
So far this series, we have looked at the Coventry Blitz from an historical perspective. We have examined the social conditions of the time and the reasons why Coventry was singled out for such concentrated attacks. However many of the commemorative events being staged in the city are not only to provide historical information and memories, but also to bring the past alive in a real and living way. This recreation of life at the time of the Coventry Blitz is being undertaken by the various theatrical groups within the city. Here at the Belgrave, for instance, there is an elaborate project in progress which gives a whole new dimension to the concept of community theatre. Can you tell me something about the project which has been undertaken here at the Belgrade?
Well, it's enormous, and it's gathering momentum as we move towards November. It's called In Search of Cofer's Tree, and it's a community play, and people from all over the city of Coventry in six different areas have come together to put on an enormous, epic, musical, amazing, dramatic piece of theatre about Coventry itself.
So you're using local people?
All local people, yes.
What do you hope to achieve with this project?
Well, the most important thing is that everyone has a good time, both those in the audience and those on stage. It's a very entertaining play, and I hope people learn a little bit about the history of Coventry and what people's experiences have been in the city since the war.
So are you using any information from the war? Is it the project starting from the war?
Well, it's part of the Blitz commemoration, which is it's obviously 50 years since Coventry was blitzed, which everybody knows now. Also, there's a lot of other things going on in the city about Coventry and the Blitz, so we felt that we should broaden the scope of it to include the experience of people since the Blitz. So it covers the 50 years, I suppose, from then until now.
What part of this project are you playing?
Well, I'm not in the play. I wrote it, but I didn't write it all. It wasn't like a traditional play. It's been very much written with people in the different groups, devising and working on their own ideas. And I'm also one of the four co-directors of the project. Because it's so enormous, there are about 155 people in it, and we rehearse in six different places, and so there are four of us responsible for bringing the project together.
Let's look at the preparations for the Blitz musical at the Coventry Tech.
The show is set in the East End of London. It was written by Lionel Bart immediately after he wrote Oliver 30 years ago. And what he's trying to do is to paint a picture of what life was like living in the East End during the Blitz in September 1940. So you get scenes down in the underground when people are there using it as a shelter. You get a firefighting interlude where you try and sort of illustrate through special effects and lighting what it was like above the ground while everybody was down in the underground. And then weave through those sort of scenes. It's all set around Petticoat Lane, and so you see scenes in Petticoat Lane, you see the sort of destruction after an air raid. And then you also see life continuing. Obviously, you know, they were very hard-working and very stalwart and very strong characters. So you get all these characters together, and there's a sort of a family conflict. There's two major families, Mrs. Blitzstein and her, I think she's got seven offspring officially, no longer has a husband, and lived, she's a pickle herring stall holder. And then on the opposite side of Petticoat Lane is Alfie Locke, who's a fruit and veg man, and the two of them are always shouting at each other and fighting with each other, and her daughter and his son fall for each other. So you've got the conflict of the parents, but the friendliness of the children. So that's weaved in with as many pictures as he can create of what London was like during the Blitz.
I play Mr. Nearness, who's a 60-year-old old fool, really. He's a bit deaf, he's got a hearing aid, and he keeps banging it, and it keeps whizzing and making funny noises all the time. So if anyone tries to upstage me, I shall whiz my old hearing aid up and drown everybody out. The show itself is an interesting show. The music is very good. There's not a lot for an actor to do with the script. The script is very, very basic. But I think that helps you as an actor, and it certainly helps the director to give you input so that you can get a lot from the script itself. Because the script doesn't offer very much, but it's up to you to do all the work. It means you have to work harder. But if you work harder, for me personally, I tend to enjoy working hard. And if you enjoy something, then you learn something from it as well. So it's all good points, really. The music is brilliant by Lionel Bart. Music is very, very good. It's very Cockney, up and pairs up the stairs and all that kind of stuff. But it's most enjoyable. I think the show will be quite successful. We're always working for a challenge, and this has certainly been one of those times.
Four years ago, Mark Thorburn asked me if I would design the set for Blitz, a show that he wanted to put on with the youth opera group, who have, over the years, developed into a highly promising and interesting group of performers. I was fascinated by the prospect of it, daunting as it undoubtedly was. Some 5 or 6 months ago, finally, we managed to get permission to do this, and what you see around you here now is a result of about probably 2,000 man hours of work in what has turned out to be quite a big monster. There are probably 2,000 square feet of bricks that have been painted on the set. A St. Paul's truck that's 25 foot wide and 12 foot high, and an exploding restaurant which I'm leaning on right now. The help and support we have had for this has been absolutely brilliant.
Criterion, there is a different emphasis. Their commemorative programme shows the type of entertainment enjoyed by the people of the city in 1940.
A lot of other children are going home. Will you send me the knockout and magic if you can get them, please, Mum? I feel a bit homesick, as if I want to come home. I hope the bombs have missed you, Mum, because I do, and John very much. Please, Mum, I'm not afraid of the bombs. If I was afraid of bombs, I wouldn't ask you to have me home with you. Please have me home. From your loving son, Geoffrey. P.S. Don't forget to ask Dad to have me home.
Let's join the TikTok Club in the Coventry Precinct. Americans are a pretty resourceful lot. They've proved this in their spirit shown after the city's devastation in 1940. They prove it again in a variety of ways in which they have chosen to commemorate the Blitz 50 years later.
The Italian Air Force has launched widespread attacks on civilian targets. The Greeks say they have captured a fresh range of heights in Albania and have repulsed an offensive against the Western Gap. 1,000 Italians have been taken prisoner. Britain has established naval and air bases in Crete. In the elections in the United States, President Roosevelt has been returned to the White House. He is expected to provide further support for the British war effort. The RAF raided Munich while Hitler was addressing leading Nazis gathered to celebrate the Munich Beer Hall push of 1923. The RAF attack concentrated on rail communications and lasted for 1.5 hours, and Hitler's speech was punctuated by thuds and reverberations. At home, the London to Penzance express train has been derailed near Taunton. 20 people have been killed and many more injured. The Coventry scheme for 2 deep shelters underneath local open spaces has been approved at regional level. Government sanction is now awaited. It's been announced that during a recent German air raid, one of Coventry's oldest buildings, Ford's Hospital, was badly damaged. There was a direct hit from a high explosive bomb, and there was considerable loss of life amongst the inmates. The courtyard escaped damage. The half-timbered building is a fine example of 16th century architecture. Coventry City magistrates have sent 2 men, one aged 30 and the other 47, to prison for 3 months' hard labour for assaulting a police officer who was on duty in a Corporation Street air raid shelter. The officer was attacked when he tried to break up a group of men who were arguing and using abusive language. Other police officers and an army sergeant helped restore order.
The 8th of May, 1945. The last all clear finally rings out across Europe as the forces of the Third Reich unconditionally surrender. For the people of Coventry and countless other cities throughout Europe, the terror and carnage of the Blitz was at last over. If the spring of that year brought the first hopes of peace, the summer brought urgent and crucial thoughts of rebuilding. In Coventry, the city centre had been utterly destroyed. Reconstruction was needed immediately. As the government planning paper in the New Coventry put it, the aim was from disorder and destruction, order and design. We asked Brian Day, an architect with the City Council's Department of Economic Development and Planning, how the plans for rebuilding had evolved.
I think you've got to go back quite a long way in time. In the first half of this century, Coventry was the fastest growing city in the country. It grew from about 70,000 in 1900 to well over 200,000 around the wars, around the Second World War. And before the Second World War, the traffic congestion was increasing. It was a city with medieval streets, a lot of problems which the City Council was looking at the time to see how they could improve it.
We then asked what had been the main difficulties.
Well, the plan that the City Council eventually chose was the one by Donald Gibson, the City Architect and Planning Officer, and he had proposed a completely novel thing at that time, a pedestrian-free shopping precinct, and had zoned the city into various areas with the education area, the shopping area, and had got car parks with direct access from a new inner ring road. The difficulties that the council had in putting them into practice, those plans, was before the war, obviously they didn't own a lot of the city centre. Following the destruction of the city in the war, the government allowed the city to declare a declaratory order area in which they could buy up a lot of the land within the city centre. And the city council now own a lot of land still within the city centre. And it's that, I think, which enabled them to put their plans into practice.
We wondered how close today's precinct was to the original.
Precinct is very close. He did originally propose Smithford Way and Market Way as a pedestrian precinct. At first, it didn't meet with favour by the traders, and they wanted to keep traffic going through because they were frightened that they would lose trade from their shops. But eventually, Smithford Way and Market Way also became pedestrianised, as Donald Gibson originally proposed.
And the reactions of Coventrians who had known the old city centre to the new precinct?
Well, I wasn't around at the time, so I'm not quite sure, but I would imagine that the traders were worried about losing custom to their shops, that they traditionally had traffic going past them and felt that they might lose this trade. I would have thought that the actual creation of the pedestrian-free shopping precinct was welcomed by the general public, the people who were using the centre. It was obviously a first at that time, and I would imagine that they did welcome it.
Yet the great symbol of the destruction of Coventry was the devastated cathedral. Here, too, plans were quickly prepared, not for the rebuilding, but the erection of a completely new cathedral. As they now stand together, the old and the new, they form a poignant, symbolic reminder of the whole process of destruction and regeneration. The cathedral also became the focal point for another crucial part of post-war healing, reconciliation. For if the hopes and ambitions of peace and rebuilding are to be realized and remain permanent, then reconciliation with former enemies is essential. At the cathedral every Friday at noon, there is a peace service. Canon Oesterreicher works out of the cathedral, promoting friendly links with foreign cities that suffered a Blitz fate similar to that of Coventry.
The links with our twin cities and our partner churches were established as soon as the Second World War ended. The first partnership was established with the German cities of Kiel and Dresden. Dresden, of course, the German city which was destroyed in a terrible Holocaust. 700 people or thereabouts, no one quite knows the number, probably less than 700, died in the air raid on Coventry. The number who died in Dresden in 1945 in the British raid on Dresden was somewhere around 70,000, just to give a comparison. So, of course, establishing friendship with Dresden was really what it was all about. They came here to express their sorrow and regret of what had been done. We went there to do the same.
As part of the ongoing process of reconciliation, the Coventry-Dresden Friendship Society was established by George Miles in 1983.
Dresden itself is an appropriate choice, as it was one of the most heavily bombed cities in the entire Second World War. George Miles first visited Dresden in 1950. We asked him what had given him the initial idea for the society.
I originally, as you may have guessed, lived in Birmingham when I first visited Dresden, but I came eventually as an engineer to work in the city of Coventry, and always been interested through out-of-band activities and youth groups. I decided to work through CCRU, which is Coventry Committee for International Understanding, to promote visits to Dresden. So I organised the first youth group to go to Dresden. I had the opportunity to bring 10 youngsters from Dresden and needed to find out 10 young people that I could send behind the Iron Curtain for the first time to see what the friendship was like in the Twin City, Coventry to Dresden. So I approached Henley College to their travel and tourism group, and immediately 8 girls and 2 boys elected to go on the trip. And I know, I still see them today, and they remember it as a vivid experience that they will never ever forget.
We asked what George thought such relations could achieve.
It's most important for young people, especially who are making their way in life, is to travel and to experience the different forms of life, not just in their own city where they were brought up, but to see basically how other people live.
Other links of friendship have also been formed. Phil Considine has recently returned from Germany.
And people are very friendly when they find out that you're from Coventry, well, from any part of England, but quite especially from Coventry. And as an individual, I've received several invitations to other celebrations throughout Europe. As
peace, rebuilding, reconciliation. Fine and noble concepts. But how do Coventrians themselves, who survived the Blitz, feel today?
Well, I'm damn glad I was stuck it out, anyway. Very glad. It teaches you a thing or two. It really does. People act differently when there's a war on. Some are good, some are bloody bad. See, that's the thing.
The mind boggles at the thought that if Hitler had have come over in 1940, there's no reason whatever to see why those gas chambers would not still have been burning today. And you see, in England, we had never lost our freedom. And people take freedom for granted. If you go to Belgium and France and Holland, and you talk to the people there, people who actually lost their freedom, they know what it's all about.
Well, I've toured Germany many times, and I've had very enjoyable holidays there. I've met the average German, and when you talk to them, they didn't want the war any more than us. And when you look around, we've done quite a bit of damage over there too during the war, especially Koblenz and Dresden and Cologne that I've seen. So we must never forget the Blitz, but remember it without bitterness and try and forgive and forget.
President Roosevelt, in his armistice speech, has made it clear that America has a large stake in a British victory. He said the British war effort was an attempt to preserve a type of civilization which began with the American Declaration of Independence in 1776. Hitler has been meeting the Soviet Premier, Mr. Molotov, in Berlin. They are thought to have discussed the Near East and Russia's attitude to Turkey. The Royal Navy has attacked the Italian fleet at its main base at Taranto. Aircraft of the fleet Airarm badly damaged a battleship of the Littorio class. The death has been announced of Mr. Neville Chamberlain. There have been tributes from many parts of the world. On the home front, the main news has been the bombing of Coventry. The Germans claim the raid is the biggest attack in the history of air war. It was a reprisal for the attack on Munich. More than 500 planes took part. Over 500,000 kilograms of high explosive were dropped. 30,000 kilograms of incendiaries also fell. Coventry Cathedral has been badly damaged. The heart of the medieval city has been wrecked. Many factories have been destroyed or damaged. Industry generally is reported to be in good shape. Mobile canteens have been used to feed the homeless. King George VI visited the city for 4 hours on Saturday. He walked for miles around the shattered districts, accompanied by the Home Secretary, Mr. Herbert Morrison. The King has made the city's sorrow his own. He tramped through the streets deep in mud and rubble and climbed over piles of debris. The King talked to civil defence workers and visited the home of the Mayor, Alderman Jack Moseley. And the spirit of Coventry has returned. The day after the raid, many shops which were open carried signs saying that Hitler would not defeat them.
For Coventrians in 1940, Blitz bombing meant devastation, destruction, tragedy and loss. In many ways, the most soul-destroying of torments that an entire community could suffer. Yet the soul of Coventry was not destroyed. And the indomitable human spirit was still able to find something to laugh and smile about, even in the darkest of moments. No matter how serious the work in hand, thoughts of one precious, life-giving commodity were never far from many men's minds. Beer.
After the November Blitz, they decided they was going to train us. As we were only the auxiliaries and we had to go to work in the day, and the fire came, duty came at night in your own time, naturally. And they sent us to Holmesdale Road to have ladder drill, as we'd never been taught how to go up a ladder to bring a person down and that sort of thing, by the professional fire brigade. We were there this one night, and our telephonist back at Alford Road rung through to say that the Grange was opening for an hour as he'd got a supply of beer. Well, I'm afraid the ladder drill stopped that night. And we come racing down Red Lane, going like the clappers to get back to the pub while it was open. And when we hit the railway lines at the bottom end of Red Lane, where they went into the ordnance works, the pump flew off the trailer. We went down Swancroft Road towards the station, and our pump went merrily down to the dairy in Swan Lane. And by the time we got everything sorted and loaded, pub was shut.
A couple of Coventrians had visions of arresting a German paratrooper, yet their adventure did not exactly lead to heroic confrontation.
And then just behind Lincroft Crescent on the same night, coming down in the light of the flames, we could see this parachute coming down. And they shouted it was a German parachutist. So we flocked over the fence at the allotments and ran towards Prince of Wales Road across the allotments. What we were going to do with this German parachutist, I don't know if we'd have got there because we weren't armed. And halfway across the allotment, this thing came down and it was a landmine. We'd never heard of landmines before, or a parachute mine. And it flattened about half a dozen houses in Prince of Wales Road and blew us about 50 yards back across the allotment back towards Lincroft Crescent. So from that point on, we treated parachute with great, great respect.
And if the bombs themselves were the source of much tragedy, they also led to some comedy.
During that day, when we came on duty, the word came round that Les Tranter, who was a well-known tobacconist, kept a tobacconist shop at the bottom of Paradise Street. And he sent word up, as he always did, that to say he'd got a consignment of cigarettes in, so he made sure that we all got a packet of 20 cigarettes, those that wanted them. I got mine, and we had a great big pocket in our tunics, like a poacher's pocket, which access there. So this particular night, my cigarettes and matches was in there, and we dived down as we heard this bomb drop, and after a while I could say, cool, that was a gas bomb. Yeah, so on there, because we'd always got our gas masks slung about, put them on, four of us, run down to the fire station, shouted there's a gas bomb upside down, caused a bit of a panic, and then after the panic had sort of started to subside, I put my hand in my pocket to get a smoke and light me, you know, and there was the reason why I got the gas bomb, was that my matches in dropping down, my matches all burned inside my pocket. And of course I was smelling the sulphur from the, as a result of the so I said, oh, did I get the stick over that.
The people of Coventry just, I wouldn't say there was panic at all. A case that we went to where houses were bombed on the Fosel Road. We went sorting out and we asked the people there whether all the houses were clear. And they said, oh, there was an old lady in number five. I said, which one is that? Because the walls at the back of the houses were all down. And they pointed the house and they said, she'll be under the stairs. So we moved all the rubble from by this stair doorway that was under the stairs and called to her, you know, to come out. And all she said was, what are you doing in my house? And you shouldn't be in here. How did you get in? And it was only then that we was able to take her, get her out of the house and to a reception area where she was safe.
Also during the raid, in Linkcroft Crescent, there was a chap who came to see us to say he got a delayed action bomb under his garage. So we went up there and we found this hole at an angle under his garage. And sure enough, we knew it was a small 250-pound bomb. And he had a very good Austin 10 car in the garage, which he wouldn't shift. So we were trying to buy the car off him. They said, we'll give him 10 quid for his car, then we'd take the risk and we'd shift it. But just when we got him almost agreeing to flog it, the bomb disposal crowd came up and dug the thing up. So we lost the chance of a nice little Austin car for 10 quid.
And when we was coming down Harnell Lane, we came to this pub, the Freemasons Tavern, and there it was, jolly well going up, well alight. And fortunately, across the road, there was a stream that ran underground and right along a pathway that took you into Hill Fields. So we immediately stopped, started the pump, and away we went. And we managed to get the fire out of the top. And the bar itself was just a smoke. Well, I don't know how to explain it. Or you could recognise a piano in the midst of the rubble, and there was all the shells still loaded with bottles. Some had smashed with all the heat, etc. But there was no end that was good. And it was just about, what? It was well light as we was just finishing the last damping down. And the nosy fire people from our station found out every pump was in working order. And of course, we soon managed to wash a few glasses, and there we were, merrily pulling the beer, free gratis, till now I don't think any of us could really stand up. When the publican arrived, he was only concerned in the deeds of the public house, and all in the rubble, as you well imagine, the money in those days was mainly half a crowns and 2 shilling pieces, as pound notes was something that was a luxury to us. But mainly it was half a crowns and 2 shilling pieces. And we spent weeks cleaning the burnt ones to take over to our local, the Grange, for our beer. Plus the fact was that we loaded the car right up with every bottle that was not broken. And we took them all back to station, and so we got a good supply of ale, what, for at least 3 weeks?
The defence against the bombs did not always follow high-tech military conventions.
I was going to mention to you an incident that happened during the raid where they dropped a whole flock of incendiaries on the rifle fields, which were the fields at Horsley, where Horsley Park is now. And they sent the messengers down there to deal with them and some of the wardens. And when we got to the fields, there's no sand and no water, obviously. And these incendiary bombs were burning quite brightly. And so we found that in the field, there's plenty of cowpats. And if you put a fresh cowpat onto an incendiary bomb, the fierce heat from the magnesium set the cowpat into a concrete case immediately, excluded all the air, and put the bomb out. And we tried to encourage the Ministry of Defence, instead of having buckets of water and sand on your doorstep, to have a bucket of cowpats. But he never really took off.
Other situations also had their lighter moments.
Anyway, we was on the station this night, and local police special come running up, chimney fire down the road, get down and put it out. Well, the only way we used to put them out was a curved piece of pipe with the hose on the end of it straight into a hydrant, so that, and just clamp it over, run straight up the roof, never bother with ladders, clamp it over the top and turn the water on full. Well, there was these flames coming out, and we turned the water on full. Of course, there was great steam and smoke going up. And, of course, it put the fire out. But just as we was finishing, going to get the pipe out of the chimney, the next one, all sparks came rushing out. Ooh. And the policeman shouted up, "Give that one a go as well, Ray." So I said, that was easy, straight over, water on. And what had happened was, a few minutes later, a woman came to the front door, and when she opened the front door, the water had cascaded out. And it was just like looking at a woman from Belsen, as she had been kneeling down, drawing the fire up with a piece of paper, and it had caught fire and shot up the chimney, and there she was, right there, and got the lot.
Not all the unexpected surprises were funny, but many were equally memorable.
What we got some wooden ramps across the London Road at Caser Avenue Junction to guide traffic over the hose so it wouldn't travel down into the hose, you see, that's the paper. And the odd traffic was coming along, largely military vehicles of some sort or another, and we just guided them over, and this car came along, you see. So we stopped it, lined it up, and then stood one, my friend, and my mate and I, and we waved the car on, and who should be in the back of that car with King George VI? And we immediately recognised him, we just saluted, and I could read his lips, and it seemed as if he said, "Well done, men." But that was quite a thrill, that was. I always remember that. This was on 3 o'clock on Saturday, the 16th of November, when he was going back to London after visiting the cathedral.
One of the awards that was given during the war in Coventry was the Dale Award. That is the actual Dale Award itself. And it was given to members of Hospital Saturday Fund and volunteer staff by the Hospital Saturday Fund for their work on the night of the Blitz. And because it was given just for the night of the Blitz, the 14th, we can only wear this on the right-hand side of dress, not with our other medals. It was hoped that they would go on as an award with our other medals, but because nobody else can win it, it remains one of its own, and we can only wear it on uniform on the right-hand side.
The good times may have been few and far between, but, like the bad times, they have not been forgotten.